I'm sorry to have been so down. This was supposed to be a happy breakfast. But and maybe I'll just throw open to some questions. I don't know how much time I've got left. But I think you need to be on the side of freedom. You can no longer rely on government, on MPs being your friend. There's a different calculus at work. Our universities are pumping out more and more people from our arts faculties. They don't see Israel as your friend, don't see Western culture, of which Israel's been such a tremendous contributor, as being something worth celebrating, and don't see that free speech is worth much at all. And on all those fronts, you lose. They're pumping out more and more people who think we should be divided into tribes, and yours is one of the smallest. I think this is bad. And I think you have got to do, which has been, in fact, one of the great contributions Israelis or Jews have made. Celebrate the individual. See the worth of every single person. And promote freedom so that person can flourish, argue, use their reason, use their free speech. Thank you so much.
We're back on the shtick after seeing a little bit of Andrew Bolt.
Yes, we saw Andrew Bolt at a breakfast session the other morning, Henry, and it was excellent. I must say I'm a big fan of Andrew's, and he actually has been on our program, Nothing Left, and we're hoping to have him on again.
There were some people who boycotted the event, who weren't happy. There's always going to be somebody who's going to be critical, and he is very controversial. Nobody I've heard, except you and Michael Bird, who say nice things about him.
The media is very left-wing. In actual fact, you could look at the charter of the ABC and read that it's supposed to represent all Australians.
Mm-hmm.
There isn't one conservative presenter on that radio system.
And television.
And television. So radio and TV, no conservative or right-wing presenters running any shows are on the ABC.
And Andrew was there to also flog his book. He's got a second book out called Worth Fighting For.
Yep, yes. And and it looks like a very good book too.
I don't know. It's just a rehash of all his articles that he's written over the last two or three years. But if you're a fan of Bolt, which, I mean, I think on the issue of Israel, I fully agree with him.
Yeah.
With other things in regard to same-sex marriage, in regard to Aborigines and Muslims, there's a bit of a thing there that I'm not sure about. He could be insightful.
Insightful in terms of offending people?
Yes.
Okay.
And insightful with the GH as well. Because, no, seriously, he can do both. He can. I mean, he is a very sharp fellow. I met him for the first time personally at this event, and he's the nicest bloke.
Oh, delightful, wasn't he?
Delightful to speak to. Yeah. So sweet. But that's what I think about all Dutch people I know. To all the Dutch people out there, I love you.
No, he was fantastic. And look, he's a big friend of Israel. He's a big friend of the Jewish people.
Very big friend, like Donald Trump.
Yeah, well, Donald Trump is an interesting character. I don't think anybody knows what's going to happen over there.
Well, the question is he good for Israel? And the answer is better than Hillary.
So it seems.
So it seems. That's the consensus.
The general opinion is that with Hillary, we think we know what we're going to get, which is pretty much more of what Obama delivered.
Which isn't much chop.
It's a mixed bag. I have to say that President Obama was probably one of the most generous presidents in terms of financial aid to Israel. But then at the same time, he's having a public feud with Netanyahu and trying to force his own philosophies down Netanyahu's throat. So it's a very interesting situation. Donald Trump, well, who knows? I mean, he's not a politician.
No.
And I actually think that that's one of the things that the people
find...
Very
appealing, indeed. People don't want politicians anymore. They want pop stars.
Well, I don't know, but I think that...
Reality TV stars.
I think that Trump's popularity is a large part a response to decades of political correctness. For years, we've seen politicians stand up and just waffle, not say what they mean and not mean what they say. Here comes Donald Trump, and he is about as basic as you could get.
Yep. He's not politically correct.
Everybody knows what he stands for.
Mm. He wants to build a fence, wall around Mexico. He wants to not let Muslims... I mean, he's doing something that nobody's ever said, and that's being really forthright and completely, you know, hardcore.
The interesting thing is that I think he says what a lot of people are thinking.
Yes.
And people have been so hamstrung these days that nobody actually wants to say what's on their mind. Mm. Along comes Trump, and as rough as he is, he says what's on his mind, and people say, yeah, you know, that's what I think too.
A question that I've been asking is, what are we going to do about Islam? I mean, there's a whole thing about it's supposed to be a religion of peace, and I saw a clip the other day. They're all at Mecca at the moment. Yes. Mecca is mega full of Muslims, and they're showing clips of people saying, oh, Islam is a religion of peace. Sure, when they're in Mecca and they're praying and everything, it's beautiful, right?
Yeah.
But look at what happened this week in Sydney. A young man with a knife in our very own country goes out and he wants to martyr himself.
Well, it's not just in Sydney, is it, Henry?
It's all over the world. It's everywhere. We just celebrated 15 years of 9/11 this week.
Yes. And that was the start of it all. I noticed that there are some Muslim organisations that want to have the word Islamic terrorist removed from the plaque outside the 9/11 memorial. Look, is Islam a religion of peace? I'm not an expert on Islam, but I've got to say that I find it hard to reconcile Islam with a peaceful religion. When you look at all of the violence around the world, how much of it is perpetrated in the name of Islam? And look, it's not for outsiders to tell them what to do with their religion, but something needs to be changed or reinterpreted if they can. Look, let's be honest. The vast majority of Muslims are decent people.
Yes, I know, but they're not speaking up. If an Israeli or a Jew did one or two things out of the thousands of things that the Islamists have done, we would be up in arms. We'd have this person locked up.
Yeah.
And instead, their mother praises them. They name their local basketball team and their local square after them. They idolise these people who have just killed, you know. And we saw the footage this week revived of the way the Palestinians reacted on the day that 9/11 occurred.
Oh, celebrating.
Celebrating. They were giving out lollies and jumping up and down. So what?
Well, the problem is not the 98 or the 99% that are peaceful. The problem is the 1 or 2% that are not peaceful because it doesn't take many people to perpetrate an attack. And in the past, we would...
Two or three.
That's it, not even that. Mm. You had one person in Sydney with a knife stabbing somebody, and that is terrorism. I don't know where they go with all of this, but somehow the moderate, peace-loving Muslims need to take ownership of their religion, because at the moment it's the radicals that are defining what Islam is.
Yeah, their religion has been hijacked.
Absolutely.
And on that note, I would really like to thank you, Alan. We've really run out of time.
Thanks.
We're going to meet Claire after the break, Claire Sentience. We'll see you then.